you don't have an optional
gauge cluster, but they put a clock in, not an oil pressure gauge.
This week on Auto Restaurant, I show you how to restore a 1970 gauge cluster and lose the clock and get an oil pressure gauge.
National Parts Depot offers quality restoration parts for Mustang, Cougar, Camaro, Firebird, Chevelle, GTO, Chevy and Ford trucks, Bronco and Thunderbirds. For quality parts in stock and delivered fast from our four warehouses nationwide, nobody beats NPD's speed and service. For your free catalog, go online or call toll free. NPD, make your dream happen.
Hey, what time is it?
You're not going to get time off of that thing.
Yeah, I know, it's useless.
Well, yeah, it is useless pretty much. And it's one of the things I don't understand about General Motors in this particular car. We're talking about the Camaro. We've got a tachometer, every other gauge you could want.
Have a gauge cluster.
But you got an optional
gauge cluster. But they put a clock in, not an oil pressure gauge. One of the most useless things nowadays, because everything that you install has a clock.
Yeah, I know, right. If you put a radio in here, like a retro sound radio,
it's
got a clock on it, you can put a clock feature in. This one, and the other bad thing is the oil pressure light that they put in here, it looks like an indicator for high beams.
Yeah, or you're turning.
Yeah, you're going to be turning.
Engine's turning off.
It's forever.
Yeah.
Because you know, on these, with the idiot lights in them, it's like 7 pounds.
Mm-hmm. If you're at 7 pounds, you've already had a problem.
Yeah, you've had a problem. And that's why I like gauges. Now, in all fairness to Bill's brother, he did have an oil pressure gauge in the car. He had this one in there. And he even had it set where the oil pressure gauge was off-center so that when it was at 60 pounds, which is about where you want to be at a high RPM run, the gauge was straight up. So you could just glance down there and know that everything was running fine.
Mm-hmm.
Good that he had this in here, but the position on the dash, it's okay. It works great, but I think there's a better solution. And in fact, I know there's a better solution. That's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to refinish this dash cluster. We're going to have to replace a lot of the parts on it because they're pretty clapped out. And then we're going to talk about a part from the guys at Gauge Marks that will fix your oil pressure problem and get rid of that stupid clock. So let's get going. I'll get the parts pulled together and we're going to start working.
All right.
All right, now I've got the parts on the table that we're going to be using to repair this cluster. Now, the cluster's in pretty bad shape. And one of the first things I always recommend that you do is to grab yourself a wiring diagram for whatever vehicle it is that you're working on. National Parts Depot carries the wiring diagrams for the 1970 Camaro, any of the Camaros really, Mustang, truck, whatever. Always get into one of these, and if you can afford it, either buy the shop manuals on CD or buy a full set of hardcore paper shop manuals. You'll really find those coming in handy when you're working on your classic car. But for doing this kind of thing, where we're going to be working with the wiring a lot in the dash panel on this Camaro, definitely get yourself a wiring diagram. Now, the big reason we're doing a replacement on this piece on the car is busted. Three of these mount points that mount this to the dash panel are busted off on the car. So we want to go in and replace just this piece. But while I'm there, because, you know, car stuff is all about while I'm there. While I'm there, I want to go ahead and just get rid of the lens, because the lens on there is in pretty tatty shape. It's scratched, it's in bad shape. So we got this one from National Parts Depot. And our dash cover here is also cracked in a couple of places. Now, I will say there are some differences between our original dash cover and the one that we got from National Parts Depot. This one lacks the light information. It says lighter here, lights, and wiper. On these three different places. This one does not have that. I'm okay with that. A purist would probably find that to be rather offensive, but in looking at it, I don't think it's going to make that big a difference. So I'm going to pull this stuff out of the way and talk about screw kits. If there's one available, go ahead and snag a screw kit for it. It just makes life a lot easier putting dashes back together. We're missing a number of the stuff for the actual dash itself. Luckily, most all the fasteners for the cluster are there, but some of the other fasteners aren't. Get yourself a fastener kit. You'll thank yourself for it later. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull this stuff out of the way, and I'm going to talk about the gauge that we got from the guys at Gauge Marks. This is an oil pressure gauge for the 1970-78 Camaro. I would rather have this on a clock any day of the week. Ford did the same thing. It's not like this is just a GM thing. Ford, when you got a TAC in the 70 Mustang, actually had an idiot light in the dash. Idiot lights are terrible. They go from anywhere from 10 pounds to 7 pounds. They don't give you any indication of problem before that. An oil pressure gauge will at least let you know if you're beginning to develop a problem. If you have a gauge in the car, even an electric gauge like this one, as long as you've got a really good sender in there, you'll know if you're driving down the road and you're at, say, 60 pounds of pressure, and then suddenly over the course of a couple of weeks, driving down the road, you drop down to 40. You know you've probably got a main bearing problem or an oiling problem in the car and you need to check it out. So I like having these on the car. This is a nice piece. It bolts right where the clock goes. It replaces that clock and gets you into a nice looking dash panel where you don't have any kind of gauges hanging out on the steering column or an A-pillar gauge package if you're wanting to keep your interior very stock looking. Nice piece. GageMark also offers some other stuff that I'm going to be talking about in just a minute when we start taking apart the dash panel and pointing out some of the things that are wrong in there. All right, got the old cluster cover out, and obviously we've got some issues, some broken pieces off of this, making it look bad in the interior. Not super noticeable, but what really is noticeable is the fact that our silver around here is getting really tatty looking. Real big problem in 60s muscle cars and early 70s muscle cars. They started using this chrome type paint on here, and it really started looking kind of nasty. So we're just going to dump this thing completely. I could go in on something like this and repaint it and redo the silver and make it look decent, but in all honesty, if I've got a new one available, I'd rather have it and lose our information that I discussed in the last scene. Just looks a little bit better. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the wiper off of here now. Three speed screws on the back. This is really quick and easy, but the biggest thing I'm going to show you is in just a second. I'm going to talk about the light switch because that's the bigger problem here. Now, you may think whenever you're doing this that the knob here, there's a little button on the back side of the switch, needs to be pushed first and then the knob removed. Sometimes that doesn't work, but what I find usually works on these is you pull the light switch out, then push the button down, and the knob will come right out. You have a screw here, and there's a special tool for it that I don't possess. Luckily, this one's loose as a goose. So I just use a pair of needle nose pliers to take it off. Now, everything was working on this car, and that's something else I recommend you do. If you're going to do this, make sure that your rheostat works. Make sure that your switch is in good condition when you're doing this, because if you are putting the old parts back in there and they're not in good shape, really kind of pointless, and it's a real pain to get to and take these apart. Last thing is your lighter comes off of here. Put your finger down inside the hole of the lighter, and you can just take and unscrew this. Set all this stuff aside. And more importantly, pitch that away. All right, now I'm going to move on to pulling apart the actual gauge cluster itself. Okay, moving on to the cluster, and first thing you need to do when you're taking a cluster apart on these cars is to take the clock stem out, and my experience with these has always been that they are really a pain. Now, the Ford side of things, these are really tough to get to because the stem is fairly short. The GM ones are fairly easy. What I usually will do is I'll take a vise grip, I'll put it on the stem to hold it in position. This one's nice because it has a screw in the end of it, making that possibly a little bit easier because you get the screw on there. You bear down on it a little bit, push up with your vise grip, then turn it, and that one was very easy. When I do these on a Ford products, a lot of times they fight terribly when you're taking them out of here. There's your center stalk. Now you can see how this could be an issue. If any kind of schmutz gets down on the shaft assembly in between the actual dial and the center screw, it's going to make that a real nightmare to get out of there. Luckily, this one wasn't like that. I'm going to pull this off, take that out. Now I can start taking apart the gauge cluster. Quarter drive, usually use a nut driver on this kind of stuff. I'm going to take all eight of these out. So anyway, I'm going to go ahead and finish taking these out, and then we'll jump back into the actual gauge cluster assembly itself. This piece should now just come straight off of the gauge panel, giving me the opportunity to really kind of look at what our gauges look like in this car. All of our gauges are in pretty good shape. And one thing I will say is the ones that see the most sun, this over here, you'll see the orange is a little weak on it. These are still pretty strong. We're missing on our tack face. This should have a lighter color, like a yellow probably here. I'm not sure what the actual color is supposed to be because most of the ones I've seen online don't actually have this, but it should go to like 4,800 RPM. You can see where the original was on here. And you can also see that we've got something, it looks like our oil pressure, it may have slipped a little bit and it's kind of off to one side and down. I remember that from when we started the car before, when we were doing our visual test outs on things. I'll say this, Gage Marks does a refinish of these. They can redo the faces on them because you can see where we've got what looks like a little bit of rust or something coming up right here on this particular face. We can get this redone and they can also test it to make sure this is going to operate the way it's supposed to operate. So when we pull this out, I'm going to show you how to reassemble it, but we are going to send this off to Gage Marks and have Daniel there redo this actual gauge itself, refinish it for us, get the lines where they're supposed to be, get this thing looking Mac Daddy, and also test out the tack because Daniel tells us these tacks can become imbalanced because they use weights inside. So if you're having a problem with your tack, Daniel can go in and actually refinish the tack for you, fix these problems that these things can have, and reface the gauge for you. Because a lot of times, this kind of stuff down in here, your oranges will be in nasty shape. And I'm going to say this, if you're in the driver's seat of the car, that kind of stuff bugs me a lot. Whenever I'm driving my car, if there's schmutz on the actual gauges inside the lenses, I get a little anal about it, and I tend to want to clean them, and sometimes that's just best left to the professionals. So, I'm gonna flip this thing over and start working on the back side of it. Clock comes off first because that stem sticks out. And it has special fasteners that hold it in place. They're shorter than the other fasteners on the desktop here. See, these are smaller and shorter. Being very gentle with my removal so as not to damage the printed circuit board on the back. And this sucker is now available for sale on AutoRestoMod.com. Not really. If you want the clock, let us know. I now have no use for it. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and start removing all the rest of the gauges off of this because, like I said, we have to transfer them. And we're going to also, while you're in a position like this, check your printed circuit board. Look for burnt circuits inside the board in case somebody had a problem with the gauge cluster in the past. The nice thing is these are available from National Parts Depot. I know that ours is in good shape. I'm not going to go in and replace it. But I'm going to go ahead and pull all my bulbs out. And what we'll want to do is either replace these bulbs, which these look pretty good, but I would go in and possibly replace these. But you'll really want to go in and do a check on these bulbs. All right, now the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to undo the printed circuit board from the back of this because you don't want that to get damaged. So you want to take this off before you try to get into anything else. And you have to remove it because the printed circuit board is in the way of getting the other fasteners loose to take the gauges out. There are these washers. You want to make sure that the washers go back on here with the fasteners. All right, now the gauges are secured to the actual plastic housing with 5/16. The rest of your fasteners on here are 1/4 inch on the back. There's one on the board right here that is 1/4 inch. The rest of these, like I said, 5/16. And all of these need to come off in order to remove the printed circuit board. Look at your board too to make sure you don't have any place that's sticking. If it's sticking, there may be a fastener there because these things can get visually kind of confusing at times. So all we have left is the one down here on this end. We get this one off and we'll start taking apart the cluster so that we can show how to put it back on the right plastic one and make it look all pretty. All right, taking the printed circuit board off, setting it gently to the side. And I may go in on my printed circuit board and actually use some 4-0 steel wool or something to just brighten up that copper on there to make sure that it's going to actually conduct well. I find sometimes that these type of light bulbs are a problem for conductivity when you go back in and redo things. Every Ford I've ever worked on, these type of bulbs cause me the most problems. The Fairlane that we're working on the show has these type of bulbs in the instrument cluster, and I'm continually having problems with them not getting good contact. Just a little FYI for you. All right, everything else on here is 1/4. I'm going to be very careful making sure to take this out. Looks like on my tack, it comes out through the back, so that's not going to be an issue. Get these out of here. I'm going to put the fasteners for these things in a different spot for the instrument cluster pieces. Don't know that it really makes any difference because it looks like these are all basically the same size, but I want to make sure same goes back in same. All right, now, one of the problems you're going to run into with this kind of stuff is anytime you're working with any of these cars in the 70s, there's a lot of foam and that kind of thing that they use to dam off for lighting. And it's no exception on the Camaro. I'm not sure if these parts are even available to replace them, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to do that if you don't have the foam parts available. Now, this is just basically crumbling into dust. There's really no way that it's doing a whole lot of anything on here. Already removed this one. What I'm going to show you is, we're going to show you how to make your own dams. And what we're using is the products you can get down at like home improvement centers and camper places. Put a camper top and water seal it against the outside elements. And that's all this stuff right here is. So I'm going to take a Sharpie marker and take the original light dam that was on the lower high beam light. I'm just going to use this as my template, as it basically comes apart for me, and I'm going to mark it out. Pull that out. Now I have my template. I'm going to get my cutting board. I'm going to put this on the cutting board and cut it out. You can figure that out. This was what I wanted to show you. So I'm going to go cut this one out, and I'll show you what we've got after we get it done. All right, now I've got my foam on here stuck pretty well. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to go ahead and put my instruments back in. Okay, that needs to go on the back side. I'm going to have to pick this up like this. I set it on its side to a degree. Now I'm going to go in and put my rubber offsets on here. Now these fasteners are specific to the Speedo cable. I'll go ahead and get them in there. Make sure you start screwing them in before you get after them with a nut driver. I'm going to turn it over and make sure they don't have anything showing. I don't. Okay, I'm going to get this finished up, and I'm going to install the rest of the gauges. It's pretty straightforward. Okay, we've got our oil pressure gauge in here. Turn it over where you can see it right. And the nice thing is it looks just like it belongs there. It's in the right spot. Looks good. So this is really nice. The piece that we got from National Parts Depot, everything bolts to it well. No problems there. Like the way it fits. So I'm pretty excited about how this worked out. This is going to be really nice. Now, the back side of the oil pressure system, you have to run a 12-volt line straight into the gauge. You have to ground it to the chassis somewhere, and this goes out for the sender and the engine bay. Okay, so the sender you're going to need is the S768P, and you'll possibly also need either a 90-degree or 45-degree NTP 1/8-inch fitting in order to make it work with some distributors that are out there. Once you get all that buttoned up, bada bing, bada boom, you have a working oil pressure gauge, and you don't have to worry about having something on top of the steering column in order to tell what your oil pressure is, or trying to mount one somewhere else in the interior. So I'm going to move this out of the way, and then we're going to move on to this end of the cluster, which is kind of a cluster because of the way GM put this together. Now, other manufacturers that I've worked with, these pieces here are typically screwed to the reveal panel. The folks at GM thoughtfully went in and actually welded this with plastic into place. Now, the bad thing is these are your locator studs, then you have these. So I have to figure out a way to put the new lens cap on top of the backing plate here that goes on top of the gauges. And I'm not sure how I'm going to do that. Another thing that the new gauge piece doesn't come with is this. There's a piece of plastic or something on here, almost looks like electrical tape, running over where the park reverse neutral drive indicator would be on a car that has a column shift in it. Cars with floor shift will have the black out here instead. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my Dremel tool and I'm going to cut these little plastic pieces off. I'm going to try to push them down and cut them shallow enough that I can possibly go back in and reset this the way the folks at General Motors did way back in the day. Now Now, if I were replacing all of this, I wouldn't even worry about it. I would just buy a brand new one and reuse and use it, because both of these pieces are available from National Parts Depot. I'm trying to retain the original. Whee! All right, you can see the difference here. These have been wiped on and they've got marks all in them. The new lens is really nice and clean. I'm gonna do a test fit on this to see how we have, what we have going on here. I've not done one of these before, so I don't know what we're gonna get when we put this on here. A little bit of a difference right here on this pin. The rest of the pins seem to be lining up okay enough. But this one right here, the pin is a little bit off. The rest of the pins are decent enough. I think we'd be okay with this, putting it back together. I'm gonna probably have to go in and mess with these holes a little bit, because it looks like the originals probably are a little more open on the 70 than they may have been on a later year model. So we'll have to open these openings up. One of the things that my friend Alan Shepley says about this kind of stuff is, the nice thing is, it is available. In other words, you're not dealing with a part that you're having to create from nothing. The part is actually out there and somebody is reproducing it so that you can use it. All right, here's the solution that I came up with. I want to use these small screws to go into the panel from the top here. Instead of going in and mushing everything back together with plastic like Chevrolet originally did, I've got everything set pretty much where I want it right now. So I'm going to drill out the plastic here, the very small bit. I'm going to use these small shank screws that I had in my stuff to seat this in position. And I'll go through and I'll do this at several of these around the panel. These are self-tapping screws, so this should work okay. I've already done one of them and it went in just fine. And the nice thing about it is, it sits fine, and on the back side, no exposed screw comes out, so you don't have to worry about it hitting anything else. Now that I've established my position for this, I'm a little more comfortable moving down the panel, cutting the caps off of these, and putting the screws in. So I'm going to go through, finalize all that, and then we'll close this bad boy out. Right, so here it is. We have it all finished up. Now I am going to try to send this off, the tachometer off, to the guys at Gage Marks to get them to refinish it. I'll also take everything back apart and semi-gloss black the area where the park reverse neutral would go for an automatic column shift. But basically this thing's ready to rock on back into the car after those two things are done. Hopefully next week or the week after we'll get all that back, and then we can go in and actually install the dash back in the car, let you guys see how that works. We may not be able to get to it next week because Daniel is very busy and it takes him a minute to go in and actually recalibrate the tach and get the faceplate done. So that's our show for this week, folks. Do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on Auto Resto Mod. Oh, and Cam, whatever he's got, I hope I don't get it.